I'm Judy Umaki, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, Vote411, before you mark your ballot. Today we have Heidi Briones, candidate for United States House of Representatives, District 1. Welcome, Heidi.
Yeah, thank you, Judy. Happy to be here.
Great. Tell us about your background and why you decided to run for U.S. Congress. And how has the coronavirus pandemic affected your campaign?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's a loaded question. So starting with my background, I got a political science degree, or politics rather is what we called it, from UC Santa Cruz. So that's not exactly when I started being interested in politics, because I did work as a legislative aide before that, but I got pretty involved then, and I started an ACLU group on campus to inform, just like, you know, League of Women Voters is doing, to inform people about their civil liberties, because I thought that was important at the time. After that, I became a teacher. I actually went and taught English in Taiwan and South Korea, also, you know, did some other graduate work and got my master's in education. What really motivated me to run for Congress was things that have been happening since I graduated from college. I actually inherited not the greatest of economies when I was graduating. We were entering into a recession, and that sort of led me towards, you know, seeking other paths and led me down teaching, studying different subjects that I was interested in, and still figuring that, you know, the economy just wasn't working the way that it was supposed to. We were told that if you went to university and did certain things, that you would have certain results in your life. And I wasn't seeing that play out, and neither were a lot of my friends. So I started to, you know, get interested in a lot of different subjects, and eventually it led me to working at a Tesla factory, working in production, and, you know, helping in that process. I saw firsthand how automation was going to displace a lot of manufacturing jobs and already had. And that led me to get involved in the universal basic income movement and become an advocate for universal basic income, because I feel like no one deserves to be in poverty. I believe that a lot of jobs will be displaced by technology in the upcoming years. And I got very involved in that community. I volunteered for a man named Andrew Yang in his presidential campaign. And I was very passionate about, you know, what he was talking about as far as universal basic income, universal health care, and reforming our democracy as well. When he left the race, I decided I would jump in, because I felt like spreading these issues and telling people of the importance of universal basic income and what's happening with technology was too important. So I decided to throw my hand in the race. And being that we're obviously in a pandemic, it's made it a lot different to run. Normally, I'd be the type that was pounding pavement and knocking doors and talking to people. Luckily, I do have a lot of volunteers that are very digitally capable, and we've been doing a lot of things online, such as on Facebook and text campaigns and phone banking and other methods using technology to reach out to voters. And so far, we've had a lot of success. So it is exciting to see that technology can actually connect us despite being, you know, quarantined and anything else that's happening. So it's definitely been an experience, and I hope to share more about it, you know, after the campaign is over, and in a different manner, perhaps, you know, do more interviews or maybe even write something up about my experience.
Great. Extreme levels of political polarization has created a toxic atmosphere in Washington, D.C. in recent years. What steps will you take to work with members of the opposite party to pass needed legislation?
Yeah, I'm very excited to work with, you know, the other side of the aisle to pass things. I think that a lot of the policies that I'm for are very universal, and a lot of them are nonpartisan. For example, universal basic income has traditionally had support from Republicans, Democrats, you know, every single side of the aisle, and sides that don't even exist have supported it at some point. You know, Alaska, a deep red state, has had a form of universal basic income for quite some time. So I'm excited to work with, you know, members of both parties, because I think that eradicating poverty is something that we both should be concerned about. And the steps that I would take is just to have an open mind and to focus on, you know, actually solving the problems for people in our district and to actually be open to working with them despite having other differences. We can differ on other things, but that's not my focus. I would rather focus on the areas that we have common ground so that we can actually work together and get things done. One other nonpartisan issue that I'm very passionate about is democracy reform and having things like ranked choice voting, public vouchers for voting, other things as well, like possibly looking into term limits and other forms of democracy reform that could help both parties to be more vibrant and get voters more active, like a national voting day, for example. We should have the day off to go vote. These are a lot of policies that I think we could garner bipartisan support and that I would focus on so that we can try to unite the parties.
Okay. What federal immigration reform measures would you support? Are you in agreement with Oregon's sanctuary law, which prohibits state resources being used to arrest or detain those who are in violation of federal immigration laws?
Yes, I believe that we need a human-centered immigration law in this country, and I do agree with Oregon's sanctuary laws. I believe that we should always focus on the human first, and it's frankly immoral and wrong to treat a human in a certain manner. And I think that we should all agree with that, regardless of our political framing. So I would support, focusing on humans first when we look at immigration law, making sure we take care of people that are here and not simply focus on punitive measures that oftentimes hurt these people and their families and often cost the government a lot of money to go through these punitive measures. So it's both fiscally responsible and the right thing to do to take care of people once they're here. So I think that we should absolutely uphold sanctuary laws. And as far as national immigration policy, we need to support Dreamers and DACA and make sure that people are taken care of and that they have an actual path to citizenship that makes sense once they're here, or open up other paths for people that want to come in here and have other different ways that people could become American if that's something that they wish to do. And I think that we should be open to accepting people from other countries like we historically have been.
Why should voters choose you over other candidates running for us?
Absolutely. I think voters should choose me if they are tired of politicians who say that they will do one thing and then somehow they just can't get it done after years and years of being in Washington. If they don't want a candidate that takes corporate PAC money, and serves corporate interests, I think that they should consider grassroots candidates that actually will get something done and have policies that will actually help them. So I hope that voters, will look me up, go to Heidi2020.com and actually vote on policy. And they'll see that my policies would support District 1 better than the other candidates running, in my view, and that we need a new generation of ideas in Washington. And that's what my campaign represents.
Great. Heidi, thanks so much for talking with us today. Stay safe. And voters, don't forget to visit Vote 411 for personalized ballot information.